Everybody got it? So our country was called Bharata. Okay? Bharata means, Bha means knowledge, the wisdom. The country with full of people who were blissful. Rati means bliss. Okay? The country of people with bliss is called Bharata. And there was an education system which was producing blissful children. The mother and father were there who were growing children in bliss. And sometime it becomes Hindustan. Hindustan, the word Hindustan came from earlier the country was Sindhu, this side of Sindhu. That's what historians say. It is not that. Its historical meaning is not because of Persian's name. Persian's called Hindu as Sindhu as Hindu. It is not because of that. Sindhustan, Sindhu means ocean. The people with oceanic wisdom was called Hindustan, Sindhustan. The Sindhustan in the name of, in the mouth of foreigners, it became Hindustan. The enlightenment and bliss was a birthright of a child born in India. And I don't know how it became India. I have no idea. no clue how in Hind, what you call as Bharat and Sindhustan. Sindhu means ocean. Okay, whereas Bindu is individual. You are an individual, Bindu. So the Bindu becomes Sindhu. A person becomes oceanic with wisdom and joy is called Sindhustan. A country of people with oceanic bliss was called Sindhustan. So that was Hindustan and that was called Bharat. And I have no idea how it when and how it was called India.
Indus.
Okay, so Indus civilization was India, but really
India and Hindu.
Sir, just like this small child which was given a name, and that is how the corruption first started.
Yeah.
Maybe this is also.
Yeah, this is actually what happens. The naming process brings a lot of corruption in India. So anyway, that's about the history of India. And we saw how Madalasa, the lady, teaches the children. Okay. Now for us, with the growing with so much of unconsciousness and ignorance in society, oh, enlightenment is something big. Oh, it has to be something to be done. Okay, all these concepts have grown. That is a social condition. That's a myth. It's not reality. So let us get into how do you get out of these programs? So the get out of this, the question now is, these programs are running in me, running in my mind, continuously. Okay. These programs are generating unhappiness and misery in me. How do I get rid of these programs is the question. This is the real spiritual journey. To overcome these programs and break these programs is called spiritual journey. Okay? Now is it difficult? Is it difficult to get these, break these programs?
Maybe yes or maybe no, both.
Why it is yes and why it's no?
Because we have never tried.
So we have never tried, that's why no. If we try, probably yes. Okay? So it is possible to break these programs, okay, which are our conditioning, what you call as conditioning, right? So the conditioning is, this we call as conditioning, okay? So as child, innocent child, gets different types of conditioning. Family conditioning, okay, the school appears or friends, religious, okay, society, science, okay, then philosophy. What else?
Media.
Media. Parents have been family. Right? So, constantly we are being programmed by this environment. Constantly. Okay? So, we are getting programmed at a time when we don't even know we are getting programmed. The child is innocent, it doesn't know it's getting programmed. Okay? So and these programs, you are living your life. Okay? Now let me ask you a question. Who is living your life?
Not ourselves.
Who is living your life? Please answer this question.
Every one of them.
So actually, your life is being lived through these programs. Are you getting what I'm saying? This is is actually bondage. This is what is the freedom is gone. I want liberation means I want liberation from the programs which are going on in me. This is called mukti. So you think that mukti is someplace? No. Mukti is a, so many programs are running in your mind and they are causing unhappiness and suffering, and everybody is programming you. Please understand. Right? So can I get rid of these programs? Can I get out of these programs? You cannot get rid of them because it's already programmed.
Spiritual programming.
That's also spiritual programming. Spiritual conditioning.
Philosophy is there.
Right? So these are the conditioning which we go through. What has gone into memory, we cannot remove it. Okay, there's no way you can format it. Right? Of course, there's one way. Do you want any quick formatting method?
Yeah,
the electric socket is there. Very immediate formatting. Other than that, there's no immediate formatting method.
We will check the voltage.
Ah, voltage, check the voltage. Right?
Sir, one thing, this is all from outside.
Yes.
And there is some innate tendencies which...
That's what I'm saying. These outside will left a tendency. At the time of death, they left a residue. That becomes innate tendency at the beginning.
Okay.
Right? Yes. So you didn't go back in a original condition. Somewhere the corrupted corruption continued many lifetimes. Every time it reinforces it.
Okay. And... So the raga dveshas are in every incarnation.
Incarnation, because there are residues. There are already residues are left. Now, how do I get out of this residue is the question. First, I have to recognize the problem. Without recognizing the problem, I can't solve the problem. Are you clear? So, don't be under the impression that enlightenment means erasing all the memories. It's not possible. Erasing all the programs is not possible. Okay? But you can debug the program and break the program. You can cut the program someplace. Okay? So that they don't affect you. Programs are there. You have a computer, some day a system administrator comes and stops some programs.
Deactivate.
Like that, some of the programs can be deactivated. Okay? So that actually is called spirituality. Spirituality is not learning something new. Spirituality is getting rid of what you have. Okay? So now what you have to learn how to stop it. Okay? And how do you do that is the question. Right? There are programs, we don't know how many. They are innumerable. Every time you pick up some program and you think it's yours. Okay? Are you getting what I'm saying? And you don't know how many are there. And when they will come also, you don't know.
See, the moment we start seeking the bliss inside, we will stop shopping outside. So why will the world allow me to stop?
No, that's one thing. So the world actually, the bliss inside, doesn't mean running away from the world. That's what I said first. Your interaction with the world will continue to be there, but internal changes happen. This concept of I run away from the world for bliss is a wrong, another program. Religious program. Religious, this thing, he became a monk, he ran away from the world, samsara, and he became blissful. So that is again a conditioning, which is religious conditioning. The enlightenment or liberation has nothing to do with that.
What I'm trying to say is, somebody who wants to be in the world, yet practice bliss, or find bliss, but even then he will find attractions are never unending.
But he doesn't get bliss because of the attractions. He uses the attractions blissfully. There's a difference. Okay? For example, a person who is not blissful, let's say he wants a jalebi. He says, masala dosa. MTR masala dosa will give me bliss. Okay? So now, he will say, I'll get bliss by eating MTR masala dosa. Whereas a person blissfully, he'll blissfully eat masala dosa. Difference is, in the case of the first person, bliss comes because of the masala dosa. Second person already blissful, he eats masala dosa, or rava dosa, or idli dosa. It doesn't make a...
First person eats for bliss, this second person eats out of bliss.
Out of bliss. Yes. That's the difference.
Not okay. Only in India, anywhere.
Anywhere. And no masala dosa, you give him a stone dosa, still he'll be blissful. Okay, for his bliss is not dependent on masala dosa being available or rava dosa being available, dhavanagiri bende dosa. So it doesn't make a difference. Or no dosa, that's also okay for him.
Huh?
No, that's blissful. It doesn't mean that he'll run away from masala dosa. Okay? If it's available, he'll eat it. If it is not available, he'll drop it. If something else is given, it's okay. Right?
Accepting that there.
So, no condition of life will affect him. Are you clear? That is called bliss. If conditions affect you, it's not bliss. Is it clear? So, these are the programs which are running your life. Right? Now you have spent 4 days and Vaniji has fully programmed you. What is the new program running now? What is the new program now?
BMI.
I am not the body, I am not the mind, I am not the intellect. I am consciousness. There is a new program, right?
I am.
Right? So, the program is? Nanu, Nanembudu, Nanalla, Ideha, Manabuddhi, Nanalla, Sachidanandatma, Shivananu Nani, Shivoham, Shivoham, Shivoham. So this new program I am trying to introduce into you. So this will break all other programs.
Sir, once in English for the...
Ah, okay. So, this actually, this what I told in Kannada, I'll tell in English. I'll repeat in English. Please repeat. I am not... Who I think I am. I am not whom I think I am.
I am not who I think I am.
I am not the body.
I am not the body.
I am not the mind.
I am not the mind.
I am not the intellect. I am pure consciousness. Shiva Swarupi. Of the nature of auspiciousness. Shivoham. Shivoham.
Shivoham.
So this program, okay, once it gets into your blood deeply, it will destroy other programs. So a guru teaches good guru per se. A program in you which actually starts diluting other programs. So such a person is called guru. Okay? He doesn't give something affirmation. This is not what I told you, it's affirmation. Okay? So affirmation, you heard of what is affirmation?
Yeah. Yes.
What is affirmation?
It's
a program in the mind, subconscious impressions. Okay? There's a person called Q, Dr. Q. He said, every day you repeat, day by day I'm getting better and better and better. Day by day, I am getting better and better and better. So you repeat. So sometimes you start feeling better. Okay? So this what I told you is not an affirmation. It's not a mantra. Okay? So I am giving you truth which will destroy me. This is not what I told you. You don't have to repeat. You have to understand clearly and get convinced about it. I'll tell you why this is important. So the child is programmed, okay, by the society and environment. Now the child accepts the program very easily, right? Why it accepts? Because it is innocent and it is coming from greatest authorities, mother, father, family, friends who are actually authorities.
That is the world for the child.
That's the world for the child, right?
Free
that's
disk
the
space also.
Huh?
Free disk space.
Yeah, memory is free, right? So the authority is there, okay? So now with the authority, when something is told to you accept it, right? So two things are required. One is authority required, since something has to be told to you. Is it clear? For that child, there is no analytical ability. It doesn't question. If mother says something, it accepts. There's no questioning ability. Are you clear? There's no ability to question because intellect has not fully developed. So whatever you give, it just accepts. The programming goes becomes very simple. Right? Same way people do religious conditioning also. Right? Have you seen these people blowing themselves up? Now the conditioning is happening, you go and blow yourself up. And how does he accept? He has a grown-up now. It's not a child. A child will accept. But a grown-up person, how will he accept?
Why not?
A grown-up person, when I say grown-up, blowing up a person, you heard, understand, right? The terrorists and all those things.
Suicide
bombers and all. How a grown-up person can do that is the question.
He'll be taken to that state of mind.
So, he is told, with this authority, you blow up. So, you understand what I'm saying? Our mind will accept something with a given authority. Right? So the mind accepting something depends on the authority and authenticity. So this text of religion will say, do this. If you are convinced that is authority, you accept it. Are you clear?
In the voice footage of those Taj bombing, in the last 5 minutes, this is precisely what came out of their conversation.
Right. So, human mind is looking for authority. You understand? You have to understand our nature, right? If you have to understand, you have to get out of this problem, you have to understand our nature. We are susceptible to authority. Okay? If something is told authority and we believe it's authority, we'll accept it without much. Right? So that's where the religious programming happens. Now religious programming happens at a much later age, much later point of time. Here some of the programs happen where your intellect is not developed, but here intellect is developed. But now you tell with authority this is what it is, that person will do. He becomes a program, another program. Right? So the deprogramming has to be done with authority. You understand? Now only thing here, the deprogram has to be done with the authority. So two things are required. Programming, authority is the cause. Authority with authority. Parents, family, school teachers, whoever tells. Actually, I remember I was in 8th standard, 9th standard. So 9th standard, our biology teacher was there. Biology teacher whom you like. So biology teacher said, when you get tired, when you go from school or care from this thing, take 2 spoonful of sugar and eat. It will give glucose in your body. Make sure that every time when you go home, you take the 2 spoonful of sugar. Okay? That was very authoritative. And eating that sugar habit continued in my life till I got diabetes. And doctor authority came in now. The doctor said, authoritatively, if you eat sugar more, you are in deeper trouble. So, we follow authority instinctively. There's a very nice song in Kannada. I don't know whether you heard of it. Kurigalu sar now, kurigalu. We have a herd mentality. Okay? Otherwise, why do you see people going after film stars, politicians? There's a lot of herd mentality. And herd mentality, you see everywhere. Politics, religion. Right? Okay? So our ancestors said, this is not the way to deprogram yourself. Okay? You need an authority to understand what deprogramming has to be done. But the deprogramming has to be done with your intellect, with your logic, with your understanding, a clarity. Okay? So you should get convinced, not because by what I say, but because what you understand by what is told. That means, you have to apply your intellect, you have to apply your logic, you have to apply your reasoning get rid of the programming. See, what I am doing now so far, please tell me, I am not telling you to believe anything. I am telling you systematically in a logical way, I am presenting the facts. So that acceptance becomes easier. When the logically and clearly something is told to you, then understanding becomes much, much easier and coming out of the programming becomes very easy. So how I got rid of sugar eating program? The doctor told me, see, the sugar which you eat, it goes into the blood. Your body doesn't have the insulin producing capability, so it will cause you trouble. The sugar in the blood causes you eye disease, ear disease, nose disease, all kinds of disease. So stop eating sugar. He gave me very, very clear understanding. So in Sanatana Dharma, please understand, the teaching is not based on the belief, based on the clarity, based on the logical way of explaining things such that you get absolute clarity in what you understand. And once you are convinced about yourself, that changes your life and that stops operating many of the programs. Am I making it clear? So this comes from a logical way of teaching called Vedanta. The most ancient system of Vedanta, most ancient system of spirituality in India is called Vedanta. So the best part of Vedanta was taken by Sri Ramana Maharshi, and he converted entire spiritual question into one simple question, who are you? One single question which will start disturbing these programs. The question is, who are you? Okay? You understand? So now, okay, you say, I'll say, oh, this is something wrong happening in the society, or this is something right happening in society. There's a program. Right and wrong is a program, right? Something which is right in this country and wrong in some other country, some other place. Society program. So Ramana Maharshi has only simple question, who are you? Which program is operating? So the who are you, the question starts cutting across many of the programs. Okay? And there's a way of logically understanding this who are you by a certain teaching methodology. The teaching methodology of Vedanta is called prakriya, process. Like your various meditation practices, there are different meditation practices. There are various ways of teaching the truths, universal truths, in a simple way, so that you get clarity on what is there. And this is called prakriya. A real spiritual master will take various prakriyas which is suitable for the student. Like a doctor will give a medicine suitable for the patient. Like that, a real master, spiritual master, will take a specific prakriya and administer in such specific way to the student. So that it removes, disturbs all of these programs, removes these programs. The job of the spiritual master is to remove these programs by administering a different process. Prakriya, you can say, for a prakriya, English word you can say is a surgery. There is a method of surgery, administering surgery in such a way some of the programs get cut. Okay? And this can be done only by an enlightened master. A realized master only can administer it. And the prakriya is a specific way the master can administer. It's actually what you call a skill. The way he administered is his skill. Are you getting what I'm saying? See, for example, some gurus will say, this is my meditation practice. This is very, very specific meditation practice, my system. Like that, a prakriya is coming from a master based on his way of teaching. Now, this will start disturbing whatever already programs you have. Okay? And the prakriya, the master doesn't tell you what to believe. In the prakriya, you start understanding what is real and what is unreal. It's a method of enquiry, right? So this is how it gets disturbed. These programs are broken. A real spiritual master or enlightened master will have many prakriyas, and he'll be able to administer it in the way, depending on the student. It's not one shoe fits all. So this, and why, how the prakriya works, I'll tell you. Okay, why the prakriya works. So when some programming happens to you, something is told to you and you accept without questioning, right? No questioning is done. No questioning. Because of authority, you accept. No logic is applied, no reason is applied, just believe. right? So there are some doomsday this thing. You have heard of this guy, one Japanese master, and many disciples went and committed suicide because the master said, on this day, the earth will end. So now they have authority of the master. They just believed it and went in. So here in Vedanta, the authority is there. The authority comes from teachings of Vedanta. It's not depend on the individual. So in India, it has been tested for 10,000 years that, and it's authenticated. So there's an authenticated method, teaching. So one teaching, such teaching is called that the word tattvamasi. Tat from asi. That thou art. You are that. That means Brahman, or you are the supreme reality. So this teaching has come in India for 10,000 years, and many, many people and saints have validated it. It's not some random thing. So now the teaching of a Vedantic master comes from the basis of authenticity of Veda. The teaching methodology depends on the master, the prakriya. Understand? How he teaches this is depending on the master. That's called prakriya. So administering this prakriya will start shaking some of your understanding. So what, why it shakes, I'll just tell you, and then I'll take you through one prakriya so that you can understand the whole process, right? So you accepted something as truth. Truth number one. In reality, it's a myth. Okay? So when you accept a myth as truth, myth means unreal as truth, it is called a belief. Right? So let me do a test. How many people believe in God? Can you please raise your hands? Okay. So where did you pick up this program?
We have been told.
Books.
Books. Conditioning.
Religious teachers.
Right? So you understand? So there is a program which says you can't get out of the program. You are afraid. Oh, if I say tomorrow there is no God, what will happen to me? To get out of this program is very difficult. I'm not saying there's a God or no God. I'm saying just giving example of one program. Right? I believe there's God. So now, does a child know that there's a God? An innocent child? So then somebody says, there's God. The God is like this only. Then this God is better than that God. So where did this child pick up from? So in here, there's no questioning happening. Just authority is administering some myth, and that becomes your truth, and such myth becoming truth is called belief. So what is difference between belief and reality? When you question the belief and test it whether it's real, some of the beliefs will fall away. Okay? Some of the beliefs will just drop. So then you don't take that as belief. So it's gone. Some of the beliefs after testing, he says, oh, this is my grandfather told it, but I tested it. So now it's not a myth, it's a truth. Right? So the spirituality is nothing but applying your test. Test what you told you as myth and find out the truth behind that. Then it becomes your truth. Leave your truth rather than leaving somebody else's truth, myth. Right? Here the question comes, how do I verify the truth? Right? Now let's take a question. There is God. Okay, there is God is the truth. How do we verify? If I tell, is there God, to my go and talk to some people, religious people, I may get hit. They may break my leg. Or something else may also happen. Right? How do we verify, is there God? Is it possible? Right? some unverifiable things is there called God. Unverifiable thing is called God. Okay. Now if something is unverifiable, then you can't either accept it or reject it.
Maybe somebody who's found it, we should search. I mean, in
case. Yeah, you find somebody who's searched it, but he still is his truth. For you, it's a myth. Right? Somebody else's truth is for you, it's a myth. Until you verify and find that it's your truth.
Yeah,
right? So now, there is God, he is the premise. How do I verify this? Like this, all your conditions you have to verify and drop what is not real. But there is a simpler way. So every conditioning requires, every conditioning, everything, belief requires I thought. So all thoughts, all beliefs are standing on I thought, belief. Because if you, whatever, when you speak of, there is God, immediately if I coming from a certain community, my God concept is like this. So my God means I thought is there. So first you have to find out what is this I thought. As you go deeper, this I thought starts getting cleared up. Then all belief systems also start getting clearer. So go deeper into I thought. Then all your belief systems start shaking. Right? Understand?
Sorry,
so what I'm saying is, for any of my beliefs or experience in life depends on me, I. So depending on my identity, the experience will be different. For example, I come from certain part of the world where women not covering her face is sin. So I say, oh, big sin has happened. Then I have to find out, who is I? Who is this I? That I belongs to a certain region. Okay? That I doesn't apply to some other region. From this country, women not covering the face is not a sin. So it all thought process depend on the I thought and associated identities with that. Start finding out what is this I, then many belief systems, many understanding starts collapsing. Let us find out how it's done, right? Okay? So let us take one prakriya, then we'll understand. First you understand, there is something called belief system, there is something called programming, which is nothing but a belief system. So deprogramming has to happen with the authority. The authority in India, we accept Vedanta as the authority, the Vedantic teaching as the authority, which we can't question, because somewhere you have to stay. Okay, Baba, there are 10,000 years, 5,000 years, people have followed it, I will accept it. So if you start questioning that also, we can't, there's no basis for discussion. Some teaching of Vedanta is there. But with that as reference, can I find out, examine my belief systems? Some reference is required. And the person who administers this should also have some capability. And such a person is called master, realized master. Unless he has overcome that programs, he cannot be a master. A blind person cannot lead another blind person. So such a person is called guru, and teaching is called Vedanta. And method of teaching is called prakriya. And understanding emerges out of that is called your realization. Is this much clear? Shall we proceed on prakriya to understand? Is it clear? So there are many prakriyas, for the sake of simplicity, I'll take one of them. Please understand, any one single prakriya will not take the fully all programs. Single prakriya can take you to certain level which shake up some programs. You understand? There may be multiple prakriyas required, like multiple medicines are required, depending on the disease, like medicines are required. So one prakriya will take up.
Prakriya
means explanation also? No. Prakriya is a process, procedure. Okay? So we'll take, I'll demonstrate it, right? So, Who are you, sir?
Amma or Ganda.
Amma or Ganda. So, Amma or Ganda is a relationship, right? It's relative.
My name, my profession, and...
So, okay. I'm asking the question, who are you?
I'm a doctor and my name is Raghavendra.
Okay. So, for who are you the question, okay? Let us do. Ask your neighbor, question, who are you? And just listen to the answer and don't reply. You tell who are you to other person. So 2 minutes, just do it. So don't give a standard answer, I am consciousness. Unless you are that. So this is a simple question for you.
I am Atma.
Don't, yeah. Here, please understand. There is a question which comes from mind. Okay? So, many people put your head, I am Atma, you can say easily. I am someone, you can say. But that's not your experience. Okay, please understand. Don't live by experience of books. Right? What you are, if you are saying Brahman, you say, I am Brahman, I am Atma, then why are you sitting here? Why are you sitting here? Please tell me, if you are Atma, why are you sitting in this Atma class? Please understand, see, we have to start living reality. Don't start, something I have picked up from books, something somebody has told me, don't start living it as reality. You should start learning, oh, is it my reality? Okay? So, I am Atma is a myth for you. If it is truth, then you will not be sitting here. You will be standing here and talking. Right? Don't miss. You have to ask the question, is this my reality? Then we can be brainwashed also into believing. If Vaniji has taught some 5 days, you are Atma. After 6 days, you start thinking, I am Atma. In the resort, you put some 40 people and tell every day, morning to evening, you are Atma, you are not body and mind. Then while going home also, your wife is coming. Do you know who I am? I am not your husband, I am your Atma. So we start believing, okay, it is not what you are. What you genuinely are is not a concept. Your reality is what you have to speak of. So now, how to get to the realities I am trying to teach you. You can fool anybody, but don't fool yourself. Understand? If you say, I know I am Brahman, I am Tattvamasi, I am Brahman, I have read some 100 spiritual books and I know I am Brahman. Fine. Then you don't need this class. If you need this class, then you are not Brahman. Are you getting what I am saying? Okay, now, ask a question, who are you? And what answer comes to your mind, sincerely, tell. Right? But don't start using buzzwords which are not your reality. Ultimately, we start living our reality. Who am I? I have to start living as Atma. Am I living? I have to live as Brahman. Am I living? Then you have not reached it. Right? That clarity, that conviction has to emerge. That's what spirituality is about. It's not about learning something more. It's not about brainwashing. It's not about making you repeat something. Okay? So now, 1 minute you just ask, who am I? And what is the question? Your answer you get. Who are you? Have you completed, all of you? Okay, sir, now we will talk to doctor. So who are you? What is the answer? I am a doctor. Okay, second?
I am Sriram.
Yeah, some Sriram. Name?
I am his body.
I am body.
I am a resident of such and such a place.
Bangalore.
Healthy family lineage.
Yeah, I am coming from
religion. When we say profession, sir, I mean, immediately people themselves, yao doctor, sir.
Yao doctor.
Yao doctor specialization.
Yao. ವೆಟರ್ನರಿ ಡಾಕ್ಟ್ರು
ಅದು ಆಯ್ತು ಜನ
ತಲೆ ಡಾಕ್ಟ್ರು ಕಿವಿ ಡಾಕ್ಟ್ರು ಅಲ್ಲಲ್ಲ ಅವ್ರು ನಮ್ಗೆ ಗೊತ್ತಿಲ್ಲ ಅವ್ರು ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಡಿಟ್ರೆಸ್ ಮಾಡಿ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಗೊತ್ತಿಲ್ಲ ರೀ ಅಪ್ಪ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಸೈಕಾಟ್ರಿಸ್ಟ್ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ ಕಿವಿ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ ಕಣ್ಣು ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ ಕಣ್ಣು ಕಿವಿ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ತೊಗೊಂಡ್ರೆ ಈ ಗೋ ಟು ಇಯರ್ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಇಯರ್ ಪ್ರಾಬ್ಲಮ್ ಓ ಯು ಸಾರಿ ಯು ಕಂಪ್ಲೀಟ್ ರಾಂಗ್ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ನೋ ನೋ ಐ ಕಂಪ್ಲೀಟ್ ಎಂಟಿ ನೋ ನೋ ಐ ಆಮ್ ಎ ಸ್ಪೆಷಲ್ ಇನ್ ರೈಟ್ ಇಯರ್ ಯು ಟು ಗುಡ್ ಲೆಫ್ಟ್ ಇಯರ್ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಸರ್ ಇಸ್ ಓನ್ಲಿ ಸ್ಪೆಷಲೈಸ್ ರೈಟ್ ಹಾಂ ಫೈವ್ ಫಿಂಗರ್ ಫೈವ್ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ಸ್ ರೈಟ್ ಸೊ ಐ ಥಿಂಕ್ ವಿ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಗಿವ್ ಲಾಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಆನ್ಸರ್ಸ್ ಓಕೆ ರೈಟ್ If you ask the same question to a baby, let us say baby is able to answer, what will one people, what will baby say?
Smile. Love. Baby loves.
Who are you?
Huh. What will baby say?
Simply she will
tell her name. No, in fact.
Simply laugh.
Simply laugh. Actually, baby many times doesn't even know that baby. So that says, baby wants food, it says. It doesn't know this is baby. Right?
Correct.
Okay? The self-identity for you, entire self-identity is defined by your environment. Doctor is a profession with respect to a patient. With reference to patient, you are a doctor. Related to a society as a function, you are a doctor. Okay? Name is Shira because of the current society. If you are in Africa, you will be, if you are in China, chun chun chun. Chun mun chun. Right? Okay. I am a body is what you are seeing, what you are experiencing. Okay. We'll come to the I am a body. Right? Bangalore is a resident tomorrow, you can be in Hyderabad or Tumkur. It's all relative. Religion is also where you are born. Okay. So everything is with reference to something.
Recently, she wanted to open a bank account.
Thank you.
And she was filling up a form and she took some assistance from me. So typically, nam yalla idra definition is all about filling up forms.
Correct.
So,
so these are all very good for filling up a form. Okay? These are all very good filling up a form. These are biodata in NSA. And as people grow old, especially in software industry, if they want to look for a job, this data will run into 5 pages. 60% of this bogus.
Resume.
Resume. Right? So, you are, I am not asking your resume, sir. I am asking whose resume is this? Who is having this resume? Is resume you? Is your biodata you? You have a biodata, I agree. But, do you have existence? Let's say I tear off your biodata. So tomorrow you don't have, you're not allowed to practice doctor profession in Bangalore. Still you are there? Tomorrow you are not allowed to live in Bangalore. Are you there? Okay. Tomorrow you are not allowed to use practice this religion. Are you there? Tomorrow your name is changed to XXX. Are you there?
There is something they say, professional death.
Huh?
Professional death.
Huh?
So it is kind of a death of a particular part.
Proper. But are you there? Are you there without your biodata? Huh? Who is there without the biodata? Huh? Who is that I am which is there without your biodata? Is my question. So of course I will not answer this question. I am the body question, I am not answering. Okay? Rest of things all are your biodata.